I still recall how I asked several questions and I kept wondering why my cell deliverance journey wasn't working or giving me expected results back then. You know, but today I've put together a few points from my experience and I've tagged today's teaching, the process to an effective self-deliverance journey. So thank you for joining me. Welcome to Why Waiting series. My name is Fikayo Adeyika. Stay tuned. I'll be right back. Welcome back. So what are the steps or what is the process to having an effective self-deliverance journey? Number one, identify the issue at hand. All right, be clear on what is happening to you. When I talk about the self-deliverance journey, I'm referring to anything, everything negative around you, anything that is causing you discomfort, every form of oppression, all right, is what we're talking about. It could be, you know, battling with sex in the dream. It could be trying to break free from any addiction, whatever it may be. This process would also work for you. So, like I said, you must identify the issue at hand. What is really happening to you? You need to be clear on it, all right? Sometimes I hear a lot of people say, Fikayo, someone told me I have issues with spirit husband, or I heard, or someone told me there's a curse in the family. Now, you cannot make assumptions. No, no. And besides, the moment you became a child of God, curses are no longer effective regarding you. All you have to do is to declare it, is to use the word of God and affirm that the old is no longer applicable to you. The old things, spiritual, moral condition. So the moment, remember Galatians 3, Jesus became the curse and abolished the curse, that the blessings of Abraham can come upon we, you know, the children of God, the non-Jews. Praise God. So you just need to affirm and declare who you are now. So, you know, I'm trying to say, you can't assume somebody told me, I feel, and don't also forget that not all waiting period naturally or invariably means there's a spiritual issue. So we must be careful in how we analyze what is happening to us. So be clear. If you're not clear, you can ask the Holy Spirit questions. You can take time to do what I call prayers of inquiries by just asking the Holy Spirit questions. Father, I've been observing this. Speak to me. What is really happening? You pray the Holy Ghost. You try and listen. And, you know, just pick what comes to your spirit, man. But if you say, Fikayo, I've prayed, you know, I'm not hearing anything. You just have to keep listening. The solution comes from the Holy Spirit. If you are born again, if you are a child of God, the solution comes from deep within you. All right? So, be clear on what is happening. So, the question you need to ask yourself when you're talking about identifying the issue at hand, which is the first process to having an effective self-deliverance journey, is to ask yourself, what is actually happening to me? All right? What am I feeling right now? And what stage am I at? Remember, there's a video I talked about the different stages with the spirit husband, or you can even say different stages when it comes to going through a self-deliverance journey. We have the conscious stage. We have the unconscious. The unconscious stage is when you really can't tell. You're not clear. You know, sometimes you wake up, you just feel something happened, but you don't have any, you know, you can't recall or have any evidence. Or that's the unconscious stage. Then the conscious stage is when you begin to recall. And that happened to me. When I said one time when I was sleeping, the spirit husband walked into the room I was sleeping in back then, and I could see the frame, I could see the height, I could see all. You know, that was not happening physically, it was a spiritual, you know, experience, but it was I could recall, and you know, I could clearly see it. That was the conscious stage of my self-deliverance journey. So when you begin to recall, you can see everything clearly, you can remember, is the conscious state. And guys, guess what? The conscious state is not the state you should get afraid or start running up and down. The conscious state is when the Holy Spirit, all right, is awakening you into realities. It takes the Holy Spirit to even recall anything. If you want to remember your dreams, you wake up from sleep and you can clearly recall what you saw. It's the Holy Spirit. So the first thing you need to do, when you're in the conscious state, no matter what you see, no matter what happened, give God praise. Celebrate God. I did it as well, so I'm going to be easy with us, you know. There were times back then, before I got into full understanding of what I know now, I would just burst into tears. Hey! But now I know better, and I'll share with you. The moment you open your eyes, give God praise. Celebrate God. Before you think of anything, just say thank you, Holy Spirit, because it takes the Holy Spirit to recall anything. Then, of course, if you are in the conscious stage, you are already in the awakening stage. Why would the Holy Spirit show you things? Why would He want you to recall? It's so that you can rise up and do the needful. Rise up, take your stand. What is the needful? Not running around, not crying, not being worried and depressed, but just being able to take your stand and say, devil, no more. And you do that via the word. All right, so that's the first point. Identify the issue at hand. Number two, the second process, all right, to having an effective self-deliverance journey is to, you know, outline what you have done thus far regarding the matter. You know, you take time to itemize, you can think through, you can analyze. I'm not asking us to analyze and get into worry and depression, but just think, what have I done thus far? What have I done regarding this matter? Okay, what have I done well? What do I need to do better? And if you feel, okay, if you can, how do I know if I'm doing the right thing or not? At least just recall, rethink, okay, what have I done? What do I need to do? You know, do I need to intensify what I'm doing more? All right, or do I need to do things differently and etc.? And now, this will lead us to the third point. Now, why is it important for us to critically analyze what we've done? Because sometimes, all right, sometimes we are actually going through the right process, all right, actually doing things rightly, but it's just taking a bit of time. And it's not a problem if your self-deliverance journey is a gradual one. I'll get to talk about the two kinds of self-deliverance soon in one of my videos. We have the gradual and we have the instantaneous one. So if it's the gradual process the Holy Spirit is taking you through, I went through the gradual process. Mine wasn't instantaneous, but guess what? It brings out the best in you. It's both the gradual and the instantaneous one, they are all the workings of the Holy Spirit. And it's good. None is disadvantaged to the other. So you analyze all you have done thus far. Then, of course, the third thing to do after analyzing, what have I done? I've prayed, I've fasted. Okay, why are things not working? Okay, then you go into the Word of God. You go to confirm, search, and find out what the Bible says about the issue at hand. All right? If it's an attack of the devil, all right? If it's sex in the dream, if it's maybe you feel there's something in the family, what is the Word of God saying about that issue? What has Jesus said in the Word? How did Jesus address such issues? That is the third stage. That is the third stage. You sit and set out scriptures. You search, you look through the Word of God to bring out scriptures that deals with the subject matter. Now, this is the crucial and most important part of any self-deliverance work, you know, with the Holy Spirit. You must go to the Word of God. You must search the scriptures. You must go and confirm what Christ said or how Christ dealt with the matter. Now, at this point, I would like to quickly talk about things never to do, things you must not do while you're going through, you know, your self-deliverance journey and trying to confirm and search out what the Bible or the scripture says. Number one, please, while searching, focus on searching on what the Word says regarding the matter and not what the world says, because you're going to get contrary. Most times you'll get contrary opinion to the Word of God. You see, knowledge is good, but and knowledge is key, but remember that wrong information won't help you, all right? And not all information is your information. You know, I get emails from people that I pray and I ask the Holy Spirit to show me how to deal with this spirit spouse issue. And while I came on YouTube, your video popped out. That's the Holy Spirit. All right? That's the Holy Spirit. I'm giving praise for that. So you can actually pray and ask the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, simple prayer. Guys, the Holy Spirit is real. The Holy Spirit is with us. He's for us. Remember, He's our comforter, our counselor, our advocate, our intercessor, our strengthener, our helper. Awesome. You need to maximize the presence and the power of the Holy Ghost inside of you. So, always speak to the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, I need to deal with this matter at hand. Whatever the matter is, you mention it. Lead me to the right scriptures, to right information, to right resources that can guide me and build up my faith on how to deal with this matter. And the Holy Spirit is always swift to do that. Because, you see, I'd rather search out what the Word of God says than search out what the world is saying about certain matters. Because wrong information will cause more fear, more doubt, depression, and other negative emotions. It will stir up negative emotions. So you must be careful not to just go on the search engine and just begin to look and look and look and read all sorts that will bring fear. At the end of the day, we'll be filled with more fear and more worry. That cannot be God's plan for us. So I want to quickly run you through, still talking about the third point, which is confirming and searching out scriptures on what God and the Word of God has to say about the matter you're trying to deal with. I want you to know that the following, I think I have the seven things I want to quickly talk about now, still under point three, are ways to know you have found right information and right scriptures, all right, or you've gotten the right resources that would help you, you know, in dealing with whatever you're trusting God, you know, to deal with. Number one, the information, the scripture, it will boost your faith, all right? It will not totally kill your faith. Your faith will come alive with the right information and right resource materials, all right, or right videos or right information, all right. When you hit and find right scriptures, all right, or you find right materials, it will stir up confidence, all right. You begin to trust God more. It will stir up confidence that God is able to walk you through the process. Number three, it could stir up holy anger. Remember, and it will give you a push. You just have this push that, you know, that's when you get to that point where you tell yourself, I'm done. Enough is enough. This thing has to end. The Word of God says that because the Word of God brings life. The Word of God brings illumination. Revelation knowledge brings excitement. Praise God. That's what happened to me. That night that I fully walked into the reality of what redemption has done for me by breaking off the covenant with the spirit spouse. That's what happened to me. After studying scriptures, remember, I'll never forget the first scripture. Like I always, I'm stuck with that scripture for life. 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, that is grafted in, joined to him by faith in him as Savior, he's a new creature, reborn and renewed by the Holy Spirit. All things, the previous moral spiritual condition have passed away. Behold, new things have come because spiritual awakening brings life. Wow. But it says, but all these are from God who reconciled us to himself through Christ, making us acceptable to him and gave us the ministry of reconciliation so that by example we might bring others to him. Now, that same scripture brought only anger. I was like, previous moral spiritual condition have passed away. That was one of the scriptures that triggered holy anger in me. That, wow, I have been cheated. The devil has been cheating me. Now I am in Christ. That means the old moral spiritual condition, sex in the dream back then, was a spiritual condition. Now I'm a believer. I'm a child of God. That means, hey, it ought not to happen. This has to stop. The end has come. That is what happened when you hit the right scripture, when you hit the right information. Now, all scriptures are actually beautiful and right. But you know, you need to look for, when I mean right scriptures, I'm not saying there's one scripture that is not right. Let me put a balance to that. I'm trying to say that you need to look for scripture that specifically speak and deals, you know, talks about what you're going through. So I said it stirs up holy anger, it gives you boldness to rise up and stand on God's word, it reveals who you are in Christ. If you get any material, any resource material, and it doesn't make you see who you are in Christ, it doesn't encourage you, then you need to run. So materials, the Word of God will naturally make you see who you are in Christ. It reduces the power of the devil, especially regarding your mind. So when you see things that amplifies the devil, run. All right? So that is why, for me, the Word of God is the Scriptures. Going to the Bible is the first solution. It's the first place you should go to. All right? Then another thing is that it won't give you wrong thoughts. Right resource materials, Scriptures, going to the Word of God to search, you know, Scriptures that deals with what we're trying to deal with, won't give you wrong thoughts. It won't give you bad dreams. It won't give you more nightmares. All right? Praise God. So that's the third point. Confirm, search for Scriptures that has to do with what you're trusting God for. Then after searching, the fourth process to have an effective self-deliverance and work with the Holy Spirit is to select. Now, you see several Scriptures. You see several materials. Now, let's focus on Scriptures. Now, you now begin to pick Scriptures. Like, if you want to deal with, you're trusting God for healing in your body, you go to Scriptures that talk about healing. All right? You go to pick out Scriptures that talk about healing, all right? List them out. You focus on that. If you're trusting God for healing, and you're picking Scriptures that talk about prosperity, you know what I'm trying to say? There's a disalignment. You must be able to search out right Scriptures, all right? And Google is your friend. You can always just go online and put in, tap, Scriptures on healing. Scriptures on, how do I say it? On who I am in Christ. All right, self-deliverance Scriptures or so. I'm sure you will get lots and lots of Scriptures. And of course, if you have the while waiting book, all right, if you have the while waiting book, don't forget the back of my book. By the help of the Holy Spirit, I was able to put together like 50 Scriptures that you can pray with when you're walking through your self-deliverance journey. So you select Scripture that addresses what you're trying to deal with, then you sit to study, you begin to meditate, which means to think, to ponder, to think through. Wow. Because you see, meditation is powerful. Meditation is powerful. Meditation is powerful. And that is why, if you look at Joshua, if you go back to the book of Joshua, God specifically, you know, amplified and, you know, talked about the power of meditation to Joshua. Joshua 1:18, this book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth, but thou shalt let it meditate during day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to what is written therein, and then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, or and thou shalt have good success. So you make your way prosperous when you meditate. Meditation simply means to pick a Scripture, you don't run through it, you gradually read it, you begin to study, you begin to think, wow. If a man is in Christ Jesus, wow, grafted in, you could quickly go and check. What does it mean to be grafted in? That's an agricultural term. When one plants, I'm just trying to think through again. But I remember that I think I checked it out. You can tell, so you check words out. You use different translation. It will expand your understanding on a particular Scripture. So this grafted in is seen in the Amplified Version of 2 Corinthians 5:17. So you look at, you don't just run through. If a man is in Christ Jesus, he's grafted in, joined in, born by the renewed by the Holy Spirit. No, you don't run through. You take your time. You read it gradually. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ Jesus that is grafted in, you think through it. I'm grafted in. That means I'm joined. Graft means to graft. It's an agricultural term, so I'm just going to, you know, explain briefly. That's a plant. You know, another plant is joined to another plant. So this plant begins to take nourishment from this particular one. All right. So that means if I'm grafted in, I'm joined with Jesus Christ as my Savior, I'm a new creature. All new aspects. So you think through it, you meditate on it, and as you do that, you begin to experience light coming through your spirit man. That means the sweet aroma of the Scriptures begin to release, you know, the Scripture begins to release its fragrance within you. Revelation begins to come. Because that was exactly what I also experienced that morning, that the Lord finally gave me full, that I fully walked into my victory. The Scriptures came alive. So you have to take time to sit down and gradually think through the Scriptures. I tell people, you know, sometimes don't be too much in a hurry to just jump into prayers, jump into, you know, sessions you want to deal with a particular matter. You have not sorted out your Scriptures. You have not taken time to sit, study, think through it. You could see, we used to hear this. I don't know how they say this, that if I want to cut down a tree, All right, I will spend more time sharpening my axe and what I will use to cut down the tree. So by the time I want to cut down the tree, I strike once, I strike twice, it's done. All right, but if you don't sharpen the equipment you use in cutting down the tree, you're going to do more work. You can liken this, all right, to your self-deliverance process. And when it comes to sorting out things spiritually, you take out time to begin to study and think through scripture. And at this point, I want to quickly remind us, I've talked about it a couple of times, I want to encourage us to consistently pray the Ephesians prayers, all right? If you look at the epistles, you will see a lot of scriptures that Paul wrote and prayed over the church. You can pick such scriptures and pray the same for yourself. Ephesians 1, 16 to 23 is one of those scriptures. Ephesians 3, 14 to 21 is another beautiful scripture you can pray for yourself. Colossians 1, 9 to 14 is another beautiful scripture. 2 Thessalonians 1, 11 to 12. Philippians 1, 9 to 11. And we'll get to pray together in one of these videos. So look at Ephesians 1, 16 to 18. Let me just read that. It says, "Cease not give thanks to you, making mention of you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him." So that is a beautiful way to pray. Father, before you start studying, before you settle down with scripture, you could say this simple prayer. "I cease not give thanks for myself. I make mention of me in my prayers, that you, God, the Father of my Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, will give unto me the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of you." Father, I receive the spirit of wisdom and knowledge, the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of you. I pray, verses 18 say that the eyes of your understanding might be enlightened. So you can say to yourself, "Father, in the name of Jesus, as I begin to study, as I begin to prepare for prayers, I pray in the name of Jesus that the eyes of my understanding is enlightened, that I know what is the hope of your calling and the riches of the glory of your inheritance in the saints." These are beautiful, powerful. These are scriptural prayers. They are prayers lifted directly from the Bible. Fantastic. Fantastic. You are just saying the word of God back to him. So Ephesians 1:18 comes alive by the time you sit down and you begin to study. Then what happens is revelation breaks forth. Revelation breaks forth. Revelation breaks forth. And that's where I'm going to. You see, if revelation can be referred or likened to light. Revelation is light. When you take time to study, you pray Ephesians 1:16 to 18 or 23 prayers, light comes forth. That was when I said, "Wow, I have been cheated." Revelation happened. Revelation hits my spirit. All right. Revelation hits my spirit, man. I saw light. Like, wow. I saw scripture like Colossians 2:15. "Having disarmed principalities and powers, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in it." Now, I checked that scripture, Colossians 2:15, in different translation that morning that the Lord, I sat down. Remember, I sat down with, what I'm talking about is what I do. I sat down like from 2 a.m. or past 2 a.m. to like 5 a.m. So revelation broke loose. Revelation broke loose in my spirit, man. So when revelation comes, joy comes. Excitement comes. You just feel this bubbling in your spirit, man. You get excitement. That's when you get an urgency. Rise up. We pray. It's time to pray. You might not even pray that morning, but there's this urgency to sort things out. That is when you get to that time, you tell yourself, "I'm done." You know that "I'm done" attitude? I'm just done. I'm done with you, devil. I'm sorting this out. Those things come when revelation comes, when light comes into your spirit, man. And don't forget, this is done. This is given to us by the Holy Spirit. We must ask for it. That's why we must consistently pray the Ephesians 1, 16 to 23 prayers all the time. You can pray daily. You can pray daily. There's this holy anger. There's this stirring. Sort this out. Fikaya, go. You know, that's what happens when revelation comes. Then when revelation comes, when you have that joy, you have that excitement, you have that stirring, then you know it's time to pray. Now, when you pray the revelation, you pray more effectively. All right. Remember, the devil will keep you from revelation. He will keep you from studying. He will allow you praying. So a lot of time people say, I'm praying. But the question is, are you praying effectively? Are you praying scripturally? Prayers that are void of scriptures is just going around in circles. Praise God. Effective prayers have a lot. in with them. It has to do with praying scriptures, praying faith, all right, praying in hope, believing, staying expectant, and that's a whole lot. Another video coming up by God's grace. But when you have revelation, your prayer becomes sweet. You pray with boldness. You face the devil and say, listen to me, devil, the Bible says, because revelation has come. But when you don't have that light, you begin to beg. Devil, you know, you begin to negotiate. You don't negotiate with the devil. You tell him to take a walk. You tell him to take a walk. You command him based on the word. Because the devil understands only the word. He bows to the word. He bows to the name of Jesus. You use the name of Jesus at such time with full authority. Because remember, Jesus has given us authority to use his name. So these are the various things we must do. And finally, the seventh point on going through the self-deliverance process is this. After you're done praying, back up your prayers with thanksgiving, with praises, and continuous declaration. Remember one of the videos I talked about, I answered the question when someone asked, what do I do when I'm done? Can the demon, can the spirit of God come back? Do I need to keep rebuking? And I just said, thanksgiving, continuous declaration is what to do when you're done with your self-deliverance program or process. Except the Holy Spirit specifically tells you to go back. Or you just feel that go back and still, you know, pray the same way again. If not, if you just keep praying, you're praying doubt and fear. All right, so you pray once, you begin to thank God. This battle is like a battle of words. You must speak. All right, what Christ has done for us in redemption, the way to take it, the way to lay claim of what Christ has done, the way to see the manifestation is by speaking and declaration. Oh, you must say to the mountain, you must speak, and whatsoever you speak, you will have. So you must keep declaring, I am free, I've been liberated, Christ has set me free, I am no longer under bondage, no matter what you see. Remember when you pray and it's as if nothing has happened, you know, something is happening. Remember when you pray and you begin to see all those funny counter-attack and everything. Don't worry. It's the devil trying to, you know, you've hit him badly. So he wants to come back and try to discourage you, because the devil knows that believers, most of the time, when we pray and we go to bed, or we just, when we're done praying, if he should just blow a little air, we get scared. But the devil blows any attack, you stand again on the word. You don't give up. You go back to the word. You declare the word. You declare what the Bible has said. You keep saying, you keep taking your stand. You don't shift for the devil. He's a defeated foe. Colossians 2:15, Christ disgraced him. One translation says, Christ paralyzed him. Guys, don't be afraid of the paralyzed one. The one who is paralyzed has no legs, no hands to fight. You are the champion. You are the one Christ has died for. Christ has broken the chains for you. You are not doing any new work. Now, it's not like, don't do works. Yes, don't. Christ is not coming again. When he's coming to rapture the church. He has done it all. He said, it is finished. And when he said that, the Bible said the curtain of the temple tore into two. And the old covenant came to an end, and God enacted the new covenant. Praise God. So glory to God. Glory to God. It's been done. Ride on what Christ has done. Take advantage. Rise up. Don't watch yourself stay oppressed. Christ has done all for you. Don't let the devil toss you up and down. Don't get scared by the one who is paralyzed and defeated. All right? The devil goes around roaming like a lion, looking, he's roaring like a lion. He is not. He's roaming around, roaring like a lion. He's not a lion. You are the lion. You have the lion of the tribe of Judah living inside of you. You are the one associated with Christ. And God will keep you strong. So, that is the seven things you need to do to go through an effective self-deliverance journey. Thank you for watching this video. Take this confession scripture at the end of this video, and see you next episode.